Shut down all military bases! Shut down the bases!
Shut down the bases!
Shut down the bases!
Shut down the bases!
Done with imperialism!
Done with imperialism!
We're here today in front of the federal building in San Francisco. My name is Steve Zeltzer. I'm with the United Front Committee for a Labor Party. Also, we have a coalition here, a coalition against U.S. wars abroad. What we're calling this rally for is for the complete withdrawal of all U.S. troops around the world.
On it now!
And also for the shutdown of the over 800 military bases around the world. We have to ask, what is the United States protecting with 800 military bases around the world? Maybe it's the multinationals, the profiteers, the people who make money off of wars. And in the capitalist press, they're saying, why did we were there 21 years? Why was the United States there 21 years? Well, why were we there for 21 years? Because billions of dollars, trillions of dollars were made by the war profiteers. That's why we're there for 21 years. War is a business, and as Smedley Butler said, the U.S. troops are around the world to protect the multinationals, to protect the warmongers, and that's what we have in this country. Today in California, it's burning up. Tahoe is in flames. You have catastrophe in New Orleans with the people, the hurricane. You have a pandemic. On this street right here, there are homeless people. There are people that don't have a place to live. And we are spending $750 billion a year for war, trillions for war. That is a crime against the people of not only Afghanistan, but a crime against the people of the world, that the United States is basically helping to destroy the world. And the military as well is pollutes the world with their bombings and their jets. And I have to give it to them, they did successfully remove They did successfully remove 121,000 people. And I think that's an example of what they should do around the rest of the world. Remove the troops. Bring them home now. Bring them home now. Let's bring these troops home now. Bring the troops home now. So one of the colonies that the United States has had, and you know, the United States is always going to war for democracy. We're bringing democracy to Afghanistan. Now we're going to work with the Taliban. That's our idea of democracy. The Taliban are going to help us build Afghanistan. We couldn't do it, so now we're going to work with Taliban. But one of the first colonies of the United States, another war for democracy, was Puerto Rico, which is still a colony of the United States. The United States went to Puerto Rico in 1889 and the Philippines to say that they're going to bring democracy. Puerto Rico is still a colony of the United States and still has bases. So welcome Ricardo Ortiz, who's going to talk about the need to bring all the troops home and shut the military bases in Puerto Rico. Welcome, Ricardo.
We are in the epoch of imperialism. And this, as long as the system that sustains imperialism, which is capitalism, will go on. So we, brothers and sisters, what we got to do is organize in an independent socialist workers' party that will expropriate the capitalist class, and also organizing ourselves as a transition in order to condemn United States intervention and expel the U.S. bases wherever they are. Right there in Puerto Rico, we expelled the almighty United States Navy out of the island of Vieques. That was through a grassroots working class movement. Not only Vieques, we expelled the Navy out of the Sabana Seca communications site that was used by the Navy to spy on neighbor Caribbean and Latin American countries. And also, we kicked out the big Strategic Air Command B-52 base out of Raimi in Aguadilla, Puerto Rico. That's the way you do it. You fight them, you occupy, and you expel them one by one. We still have the odious Camp Santiago, where they train Latin American troops there, and it's used to foment aggression against the working class everywhere. And also the Muñiz Air Base located in the neighborhood of the neighbor city of Carolina in the international airport, where you know it's a U.S. Air Force base that has been used to strike against Grenada. It was used to do the invasion of Grenada along with Roosevelt Rose, which we spell out of the country. So the tax is tedious, but it's not impossible. And let me speak something, because yes, the United States has 800 bases around the world, but let me tell you that they are not the only ones that are doing military interventions. I will speak about the country of France. France has performed more than 100 military incursions into the African continent since 1970. The latest, Operation Serval in Mali and other sub-Saharan countries. Why? Because France owns a lot of mineral and oil and water resources in Africa, and they do have approximately half a dozen bases around the African continent. And you know, they do have colonies, actually, not far from us, right here in the Pacific, so-called French Caledonia, you know, which is the island of Tahiti. The French imperialists have sent troops during the 80s in order to combat independence movement that was a working class, mostly a working class native organization. And it was crushed by the French imperialism. The French blew up the ship, green ship, of the Greenpeace organization more than 2 decades ago. They were French commandos, the ones that blew that ship. And who was ruling the country? The so-called socialist government of François Mitterrand. So if you think for a second that social democracy is friends of the people, I tell you, no. Down with the reformists, down with the imperialists. USA out of Puerto Rico, out of the Caribbean basin, out of the world. Let's make a workers' revolution.
Welcome all, dear comrades, brothers, sisters, siblings. How are we doing today?
Good, thank you, Ali.
All right, I came here to speak. My name is Ali. I came here to speak on behalf of Revolutionary Workers' Party in Turkey. First order of business. Some people say, oh my God, now that the US is withdrawing, our beloved Western overlords are withdrawing, the situation with Afghan women and democracy will be abysmal. Oh, how sad. The U.S. never, ever brought democracy in one single goddamn place on the face of this earth.
That's true.
The regime that the U.S. was defending in Afghanistan was officially called the Islamic Republic of Afghanistan. Does that sound like democracy to you?
Democracy. No.
Does that sound like defending women's rights to you?
No.
The U.S. Army benefited from forced prostitution of Afghan women for these goddamn 2 decades that it stayed in Afghanistan. Does that sound like feminism to you?
No.
Does that sound like defending women's rights to you?
No.
Then what the hell was the U.S. defending?
War profiteering.
War profiteering, that's right. Multi-billion dollars of Raytheon investments and its geopolitical interests against Russia and China. That's what it was defending. Am I right, folks?
Oh, yes.
Hell yeah. I'm from Turkey. Turkey's a NATO ally. It has a bunch of American bases. İncirlik and Türecik are the biggest of the two. It is using the US Army and the other NATO forces are using these military bases to bomb countries like Iraq and Afghanistan and Yemen. So I'm calling from here to all the workers of the world who belong to countries, who are from countries that belong to NATO. Force your governments to get the hell out of NATO. It's not bringing you any good. It's driving your wages down, driving your rights down, and just leveling up the profits of your own bosses and the bosses here in the United States.
No to NATO!
No to NATO!
No to NATO!
Disband NATO!
Disband NATO!
So our next speaker is Lisa Milos. And Lisa is a member of UPTE, United Professional Technical Employees, a rank and file member. Recently, her committee passed a resolution for the Palestinians, for recognition of the Palestinians and against U.S. support to the Israeli government. Welcome, Lisa.
I'm also a Chilean American. And
Viva Chile!
And as most of you already have know, there was a major insurrection or major revolt in October 2009, which was against the neoliberalism, the economic system that was imposed against the Chilean people by the U.S. Via the Pinochet government in 1973. Now, there's a military base in Chile as well, in Concon, and the presence of all of these military bases are also training ground for torture, such as the School of the Americas. And in Chile, for example, from October 2019, March 2020, there were 460 people who lost an eye because of the police and military shooting pellets into the people's eyes, targeting people's eyes. That is mutilation. That's the same kind of mutilation that the Israeli army has been doing against the Palestinians. And the situation with regard to the United States and Israel is the following. Jewish Voice for Peace took out an important report called The Deadly Exchange, where the police departments in this country get trained by Israel, apartheid Israel, to mutilate, to attack, and to kill people in so-called crowd control. They also are major war manufacturers, just like the US, and selling weapons. And Israel sold weapons to Pinochet during the time when the US government was not allowed to sell weapons to Chile, to Pinochet. Israel did that. Israel sent weapons, sold weapons to the Rios Montt government of Guatemala, which killed more than a million Mayan indigenous people in the 80s. They keep doing it. This cultural militarism that the United States has bred during its entire existence must end. It's militarism and also the prison system. They're intertwined. A lot of these ex-veterans become either mercenaries that attacked the indigenous people in Standing Rock, or there's more deaths among veterans by suicide than the entire Iraq and Afghanistan war combined. We find veterans in the streets. They don't get any kind of support when they do come back. So we need to bring them home, give them the support they need, and end this militaristic culture once and for all. Yeah. The only way we're going to be able to do that is by supporting and the creation of a labor party. Because these veterans that go to war generally don't see that they have a choice. It is called an employment system for them. They literally end up having to lose an arm and a leg in order to pay for their education.
Yeah.
That is unacceptable. We cannot allow that system to continue. Our young people do not deserve that. Our future must change. And the only way we can do that is with a Labor Party, a United Labor Party. Thank you.
Thank you, Lisa. So our rally today, our action, is to stop these crimes by the U.S. government and the Democratic and Republican Party. They are crimes against the people of the world. They're crimes against the people right here in San Francisco. So one of the issues that we're here for is Pelosi, Nancy Pelosi, who's leader of the Democrats. And I think we have Nancy Pelosi here with us today. She's usually hard to find, but she came back to San Francisco to talk about why we need the military and why we're doing such a great job. So welcome Cynthia Papermaster from Code Pink.
Hello, everybody. Somebody gave me this when I was walking over here. It says, defund
the police and defund the Pentagon, fund the communities and fund life. You know, I just have to say that is so wrong-headed. The Pentagon is our friend.
No!
Not only that, but, you know, I give over half of the federal tax budget to the Pentagon, and with good reason. You know what?
No!
We billionaires need the Pentagon, and we need Lockheed.
No!
Now, wait a minute. I'm the queen. Oh, excuse me, I'm not. This is a democracy, and you vote for me every time.
Oh.
Haven't you voted for me for 20 years so we could have that war in Afghanistan?
No.
Are you kidding me? You didn't vote for me?
We don't even like you.
What?
No.
People adore me. Look, what do you have there? What is that? Show it.
We told you not to go to Afghanistan 20 years ago.
Show it.
You didn't listen.
Wait a minute. What's this? What's this?
Listen.
I'm gonna put my champagne.
Show it back.
I'm gonna put my champagne glass down. You hippies and commies, you're always disrupting me when I'm trying to speak.
That's right. Sorry, yeah.
Whoops.
Soros pays us to do that.
Sip it. Somebody came to my house a couple weeks ago. Can you believe that? How rude! How rude! They came to my house.
11 Normandy Street, right? Is that your house?
I'll tell you the address in a minute. Okay, and look what they left on my front door. Emergency intervention for Nancy Pelosi, and we're here to help you, as if. You know, we think you're ill with an addiction to giving our money to the Pentagon. Forever wars and weapons funding. How else can your actions be explained? This emergency intervention is on behalf of your constituents and the millions of people around the globe who are victims of U.S. militarism, the racism and patriarchy inherent in U.S. wars, the climate emergency that you continually buy with our money, the $8 trillion. I mean, it was $2 point something trillion, I'm sorry, Pelosi approved for the Afghan war, where 90% went to the military and 10% went to helping Afghanistan. That is a clear evidence of your addiction, Nancy Pelosi. Don't you love your children and all beings, Nancy? Please stop giving the Pentagon our money to make war. War is literally killing the planet. You can kick your terrible habit, they say. Admit you have a problem and shake it off and stop leading the Democrats in Congress to give our money to the Pentagon, Lockheed, Boeing, Grumman.
Boo!
Lockheed, Boeing, Grumman.
Boo!
Raytheon.
Boo!
Who are killing people all over the world with our tax dollars.
Boo!
That's right, we fund them and then they go and bomb other countries. A few weeks ago we were at Union Square. I'm not gonna be Nancy Pelosi now. A few weeks ago we were at Union Square for a memorial for 40 children killed by a Lockheed bomb in Yemen 3 years ago. That's Lockheed Martin.
Yeah.
What were their profits during the Afghan war? Over 1,000%. Over 1,000% return on investment if you invested in Lockheed. Those war profiteers have got to stop. What can we be doing with that money instead?
Healthcare
for all?
Housing.
Pelosi's against it.
Housing.
How about a Green New Deal? Pelosi's against it.
Yeah.
How about affordable housing? Pelosi's against it.
How about a black, brown, and green new deal?
How about a black, brown, and green new deal and a red new deal too?
Yeah.
Pelosi is against using our money for life. And we're calling her out and saying, you're addicted to war, Nancy, you need to get help. We're gonna help her, and we're gonna get an action to stop war funding, because war profiteers are who benefited from the Afghan war. No one else. Anyone else? Anyone else benefited from that war?
No.
Ask the thousands of people who died, the children, the women who've been bombed in Afghanistan with drone assassinations. I got worked up, I'm sorry.
Good.
Pelosi! Stop it!
Again, the money, the wealth of the United States is spent for war because war is profitable to these multinationals, to the war, the industrial military complex, who benefit from the war. And that's why the United States has wars abroad. They're not for the people of the rest of the world. They're for profiteers, for war profiteers. And these politicians, Nancy Pelosi, Feinstein, Kamala Harris, Biden, they have blood on their hands.
Absolutely.
They have blood on their lands. They're literally killing people because of votes for more wars. When people are dying in this country from hunger, when people are dying from lack of health care, and they're spending money for war. They're war criminals, and they actually should be put on trial as war criminals for what they've done. Let's put Pelosi and company on trial for war criminals. Our next speaker is Charles Rackless, and he's with the Communist Workers Group.
My name is Charles Rackless. I'm here to speak on behalf of the Communist Workers Group and the International Leninist Trotskyist Tendency. First, I want to say we support this action to close the 800 more bases around the world, which are there solely for the interests of the capitalist ruling class in the United States and to maintain the imperialist profit-taking structure. Here to explain that the working class and the capitalist class have no interests in common, and that issues of war and peace are working class issues. I remember 20 years ago, many of the people here in this crowd, we were together just blocks away from here on February 14th and 15th to oppose the U.S. war that was about to go down in Afghanistan. We turned out here and in 600 countries and demonstrations around the world. There was the largest anti-war mobilizations around the world. But it was not sufficient. It was not sufficient here. It was not sufficient around the world to stop the U.S. war machine. It was not sufficient is because the leadership of the working class in the trade union movement, the bureaucracy of the trade union movement tied to the war party, the imperialist democratic party in the United States, and to social democratic parties around the world, support their capitalist class. And what they did was they hitchhiked a ride on the 9/11 national chauvinist mobilization and war whooping cry that was made up after the criminal attack on the World Trade Center and 3,000 people died here. So they used that as an excuse to go to war in Afghanistan. No one from Afghanistan attacked the World Trade Center. Who came?
The Saudis.
They were Saudi Arabians.
Yeah.
Now let's think about Saudi Arabia. 13 U.S. presidents have visited Saudi Arabia since FDR. Yeah. Who's the friends of Saudi Arabia and Wahhabism? Who is it that's opposing the rights of women around the world?
Yeah.
It's the U.S. presidents who are sustaining the Saudis.
Woo!
Why? Because they can make a buck off the oil deal. Now, they had other reasons. They had other reasons because we're in a situation... someone explained before that we're in an epoch of imperialism. And in the epoch of imperialism, we're in a struggle between permanent revolution and permanent counter-revolution. Permanent revolution because the tasks of the democratic revolutions that broke out in 1680s in England, in 1770s in the United States, 1780s in France, 1840s in France and across Europe, cannot be completed around the world by the capitalist class in the semi-colonies who are now subordinated to imperialism. Those revolutions are not complete, and people around the world are now subordinated by these imperialist powers who take advantage and take their super profits from control of these countries with the support of the national capitalist class in those countries.
So the United States has a hand in the Middle East and North Africa and Eurasia. And it's a great game for control of that area. And that's been going on for 200 years. Now the Soviet Union, when it was the Soviet Union, had its own interests in going into Afghanistan, even though it was provoked by Brzezinski and the Charlie Wilson War. They had their own reasons because the forces of revolution in Afghanistan were unleashed by the conditions of the people there. And the Soviet leadership was not really in favor of advancing the national revolution in Afghanistan. They were there for a decade and were driven out with the support of the United States, which financed the Mujahideen, which established the beginnings of the Taliban and came back to kick us in our butt. Now, the Great War is still on, and the United States is still trying to surround Russia and China in an inter-imperialist struggle for control of the semi-colonies. And right now, the United States is in decline. The United States economy is in decline, and China is on the uplift with their Belt and Road Initiative, and they're trying to promote that they have a win-win solution for the semi-colonies. But indeed, it's not a win-win solution. They themselves are the new imperialist power, and they're facing off against U.S. imperialism. And as communists and socialists and workers around the world, we oppose all imperialist wars. We take no side to support either imperialist parties when they struggle over the control of the semi-colonies. We support the workers in the world as they struggle against control by imperialism. Now, how are we going to stop these inter-imperialist wars? The mass demonstrations were not sufficient. Tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands turned out. And then in 2008, the ILWU here, Local 10, turned out on May Day to say stop the war. That was a one-day exemplary action. But what we need to do is have general strikes, massive strikes of workers around the world to stop imperialist wars and end the role of imperialism. So, in closing, we support the building of a come home now movement of all the troops around the world for the formation of unions of soldiers, sailors, and Air Force personnel that elect their own leadership, that stand against any illegal orders, that mobilize the troops to come home now and close the bases, because we know that those bases are only there, as our sister explained, for Raytheon and Boeing, etc. Now, just a final few words back on the issue of what just happened in Afghanistan. They say 166,000 people were killed by the war. 300,000 more died from the consequences of the war. And that was supposed to be retribution for what happened at the World Trade Center? No. That's not how you end so-called terrorism around the world. You end it by ending the causes and the poverty. And that cannot be done by the U.S. ruling class. It can only be done by the working class taking power. And that's why the Communist Workers Group supports all efforts to build a workers' party, like the United Front Committee for a Labor Party that's struggling for political independence of the working class. Because if we had a workers' government in the United States, we would bring all the troops home now. We would close all the foreign bases. We would extend the technological support that's needed to the people of the world to give themselves some power, electricity, water, education, hospitals. We would do that because we can mobilize the power of the working class to create what the wealth that we have and hold it on to ourselves instead of turning it into stock profits for the big shareholders. So the Communist Workers Group advances the struggle for mass strikes against the wars, for educating the working class against inter-imperialist wars, for building solidarity of all the workers across the world, and and building revolutionary workers' parties and a revolutionary workers' international. Thank you, brothers and sisters, friends and siblings.
Our next speaker is Dolores Perez Heilbronn with the First Unitarian Universalist Society Human Rights Working Group. Welcome, Dolores.
Thank you, all my old friends here. It's great to see you. Well, I want you to know that our church, the First Unitarian Universalist Society of San Francisco, in 2002 passed a resolution asking the government under George W. Bush, to not go forward with their bombing of Baghdad. You all remember that. And that resolution was passed by an overwhelming majority of the members of our congregation. And since then, we've gone to Nancy Pelosi's office. I see many of you here today that went to Nancy Pelosi's office with me and Father Louis and a lot of other people for years to ask Nancy Pelosi not to pass a military budget, but she did anyway. Then she told us, well, if a Democrat gets in the White House, that's going to change. A Democrat got in the White House, Barack Obama, nothing changed. No, same old story. So anyway, what I want to focus on today is a story from the Military Times. The Military Times, here it is. From Monday, June 21st of this year, by Megan Myers. Four times as many troops and vets have died by suicide as in combat. The suicide rate among active duty troops and veterans has outpaced the population in recent years. But with so many risk factors inherent to military life, it is difficult to pin down why. Anyway, it goes, the Military Times goes on to say, the report notes that increasing rates of suicide. The report notes that increasing rates of suicide for both military veterans and active duty personnel are outpacing those of the general population. So, per researchers' estimates, 3,177 global war on terrorism veterans have died by suicide, compared to 7,057 who have died while deployed in support of the global war on terror. Thank you. Can you hear me now? Okay, so four times as many soldiers die from suicide after they get out of the war. So imagine what we have to look forward to. And now here's another, I think things are changing though. Here's another article from the New York Times from yesterday. History is clear. America's military is way too big. This is by Jeremy Surley, who teaches history at the University of Texas in Austin. History is clear. We would be better off with more modest, restrained military and strategic goals. U.S. public opinion seems to have moved in this direction, too. Our country needs to re-examine the value of military dominance. The reliance on military force has repeatedly entangled the United States in distant, costly, long conflicts with self-defeating consequences in Vietnam, Lebanon, Iraq, Afghanistan, and other places. American leaders have consistently assumed that military superiority will compensate for diplomatic and political limitations. Time and time again, despite battlefield successes, our military has come up short in achieving its stated goals. So, you can read this yourself. It's in the New York Times, and it ends with, we must be honest about what the military cannot do. We should allocate resources to other organizations and agencies that will actually make our country more resilient, prosperous, and secure. We will benefit by returning to our history as a big country with a small peacetime military. So this is from the people way up there, the big corporations, and we have to try to influence all the people, working class people and all classes of society, to join together to stop this military expenditure that just is destructive to everybody. Thank you.
Our United Front Committee for a Labor Party, as Charles and others have said, is for a Labor Party, a Workers' Party, which is against imperialism, against war, against militarization, and for workers' control of this country. And also, I wanted to announce that there are brothers and sisters in Namibia who are also fighting against Chinese and foreign capitalists who are pushing them off their jobs, union busting and privatizing their economy, and forcing contract labor, which is going on. We have so many temporary workers in this country. The reason for the temp economy is to further exploit workers, to rip them off. And we need to fight contract labor privatization. So on October the 27th, there's going to be a worldwide day of action against contract labor, against union busting, against privatization, which we have in this country and around the world. And we're going to be supporting that and joining with the Namibian miners, workers in South Africa in the mines, who are also fighting union busting and assassinations of union organizers, of NUMSA, which happened in South Africa last week, where a union organizer was assassinated who was trying to organize workers against the contract labor.
Shut down the bases!
Shut down the bases!